بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. إن الحمد لله نحمده ونستعينه ونستغفره ونستهديه ونؤمن به ونتوكل عليه ونعوذ بالله العظيم من شرور أنفسنا ومن سيئات أعمالنا، من يهده الله تعالى فلا مضل له ومن يضلل فلن تجد له وليا مرشدا. أشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وحده لا شريك له، له الملك وله الحمد، يحيي ويميت وهو حي لا يموت، بيده الخير وهو على كل شيء قدير. أشهد أن محمدًا عبده ورسوله وصفيه وخليله، أدى الأمانة وبلغ الرسالة ونصح للأمة وكشف الغمة، وتركنا على المحجة البيضاء ليلها كنهارها لا يزيغ عنها إلا هالك، فعليه أفضل الصلاة وأتم التسليم، وعلى آله وصحبه ومن استنى بسنته إلى يوم الدين. اللهم اجعلنا منهم ومن الذين آمنوا وعملوا الصالحات وتواصوا بالحق وتواصوا بالصبر. آمين يا رب العالمين. وأوصيكم ونفسي بتقوى الله عز وجل، وقد أمرنا بالحق، وقال تعالى: يا أيها الذين آمنوا اتقوا الله حق تقاته ولا تموتن إلا وأنتم مسلمون. يا أيها الناس اتقوا ربكم الذي خلقكم من نفس واحدة وخلق منها زوجها وبث منهما رجالا كثيرا ونساء، واتقوا الله الذي تساءلون به والأرحام، إن الله كان عليكم رقيبا. يا أيها الذين آمنوا اتقوا الله وقولوا قولا سديدا يصلح لكم أعمالكم ويغفر لكم ذنوبكم، ومن يطع الله ورسوله فقد فاز فوزا عظيما. أما بعد، we begin by praising Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. We bear witness that none has the right to be worshipped or unconditionally obeyed except for Him subhanahu wa ta'ala. We thank Him and we acknowledge His perfection and we acknowledge our own imperfections. We acknowledge His blessings upon us and our sins that have ascended towards Him. We ask Him to forgive us for our shortcomings, and we bear witness that Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam is His final messenger who was sent to mankind as a mercy and as a guide. And we ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to make us amongst those that accept that guidance, that follow His example, and that are eventually gathered with Him and His family and His companions in the highest level of Jannah al-Firdaws. Allahumma ameen. Dear brothers and sisters, if I was to ask you, and if this wasn't a khutbah where you could respond, I'm sure if I was to ask this question, I would probably not get the correct answer. If I was to ask, who is the first Nabi, the first Prophet that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has mentioned to us in the Qur'an, that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala warned the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam with, or admonished the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam with his example, I'm sure that most people would say it's probably Musa alayhi salam. Because the example of Musa alayhi salam is so frequent throughout the Qur'an, you can hardly read through a Madani surah, a surah that was revealed in Medina, without a mention of Musa alayhi salam. And as Al-Alusi rahimahullah commented, that the entire Qur'an almost was a story of Musa alayhi salam. It's frequent in the Qur'an, you find many prophets, many examples that are mentioned throughout the Qur'an. You find the story of Yusuf alayhi salam was revealed to the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam in his most difficult times. However, the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam was given the example of a certain prophet early on. And it's the first example that was given to the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam to him. And it was also in the same surah in which the first example was given to Quraysh, where Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, فَاصْبِرْ لِحُكْمِ رَبِّكَ وَلَا تَكُنْ كَصَاحِبِ الْحُوتِ إِذْ نَادَى وَهُوَ مَكْذُومٌ. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said, so be patient with the command of your Lord, and do not be like صاحب الحوت, do not be like the companion of the whale, the Prophet Yunus alayhi salam, who would be named in later surahs as Yunus, as Dhun-Nun. But here, لَا تَكُنْ كَصَاحِبِ الْحُوتِ, don't be like the companion of the whale. Allah Azza wa Jalla did not leave it there. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said specifically, إِذْ نَادَى وَهُوَ مَكْلُومٌ, when he called upon Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala as he was swallowed. Because Yunus alayhi salam is a great prophet. He's a great Nabi. He's one that we can take many lessons from. But particularly in that instance, Allah is warning the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, don't give up like Yunus alayhi salam once did. And it's interesting because in this surah, Surah Al-Qalam, which was revealed in the very early days of Islam, Allah Azza wa Jal also warned Quraysh, إِنَّا بَلَوْنَاهُمْ كَمَا بَلَوْنَا أَصْحَابِ الْجَنَّةِ. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says that we have tested them the way we tested the people of the garden. And Allah gives the story of the people of the garden. And just briefly, because it connects very much so to what we've been speaking about in previous weeks about risk and sustenance and trusting in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and understanding that Allah gives to the one who earns in a halal way and who acts in accordance with His guidance. Just briefly, the story of the people of the garden were a people that set out who had a very generous father that used to give from this vast garden of his to the poor, and they used to show up every single morning. And then his children were ungrateful. And they said that we will go out one night and we will take all of the fruits, we'll pick everything so that the poor people will not have anything left for them. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala instead completely destroyed their garden. So that was the first method, the first analogy that was given to Quraysh. Don't be like those people. And these were people that felt like the dunya was in their hands, that waited to see their own fruits, that felt like their own fruits were in their own hands, but would come to realize that they were from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and to the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam a warning that you should understand that the fruits of your da'wah are also in the hands of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, just as the fruits of their dunya are also in the hands of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. فَاصْبِرْ لِحُكْمِ رَبِّكَ. So be patient with the command of your Lord. وَلَا تَكُنْ كَصَاحِبِ الْحُوتِ إِذْ نَادَى وَهُوَ مَكْذُومٌ. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala tells us about the story of Yunus alayhi salam, this prophet that was very similar to Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, in that he was sent to a people that did not believe in any gods. He was sent to pagans, people that believed in many gods. I'm sorry, that were not people of the book. They weren't Ahl al-Kitab. They were also unique in that they also denied Akhirah. They denied the existence of a hereafter, which is very, very, very rare. In the history of the world, you don't find many people that denied the existence of an Akhirah, even if they had a skewed understanding of it. So Yunus alayhi salam was similar to the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam in that, and he called the people, Yunus ibn Matta, he called the people in a land called Nineveh in Iraq. And eventually, as he continued to call his people and warn them, he warned them of the punishment of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and gave them 3 days. As Allah azza wa jalla used to give destroyed nations a warning. Now usually what happens when a Nabi warns his people of the punishment, they increase in their mockery. As we see in the story of Nuh alayhi salam, the story of Hud alayhi salam. Usually when you tell these people who are so arrogant to accept the guidance of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, too arrogant to accept the guidance of Allah, they will simply mock you even further. Now the people of the Prophet ﷺ, Quraysh, they were worried about the Akhirah. They knew what the Prophet ﷺ had was true. And in fact, sometimes when they asked the Prophet ﷺ, as Imam ibn Qayyim rahimahullah said, when Quraysh would ask the Prophet ﷺ, Mata sa'a, when is the hour? Part of it was mockery and part of it was, we want to get ourselves ready right before the Day of Judgment comes. So they would put their hands on the mouth of the Prophet ﷺ when he started to talk about the Day of Judgment and the destruction from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. But their arrogance kept them from accepting the message. With Yunus alayhi salam, he warns his people. And then he leaves his people without being given permission by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And he goes to board a ship, as we all know the story. And in that time period, in those few days, as the people see the clouds gathering above them, they did something which is very untraditional. They made tawbah to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. They accepted the message of Yunus alayhi salam, even as he abandoned that call and set out to the ship, and they started to seek forgiveness from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. In the meantime, Yunus alayhi salam sets out, he boards a ship with these people. As these people are out, and subhanAllah, these clouds that came that were supposed to destroy the people of Yunus alayhi salam, instead the weather became very severe and that ship started to shake violently. And so they all were forced to throw their luggage overboard. And then eventually the luggage was not enough, and so they cast lots to see who they would throw overboard amongst them, and they chose, the lots came out to Yunus alayhi salam. And this Prophet of Allah, who left his people thinking that they have denied the message and that they would never come back and that there was no hope in them and that the destruction of Allah was coming to them anyway, instead is thrown off of the ship in the darkness of the night, and he's thrown in the middle of the ocean. And while he's thrown into the ocean, this huge whale comes and swallows him and then plunges all the way to the depths of the ocean. And as Ibn Mas'ud radiallahu ta'ala anhu said, imagine, he was in the dhulumat, the darkness of the nights, under the darkness of the ocean, in the darkness of the stomach of that whale, all the way at the bottom of that ocean. Imagine what Yunus alayhi salam was going through. And in fact, when Yunus alayhi salam woke up, he thought he was dead. Because I mean, imagine if you were in that situation, he thought he was dead. Then he realized he could move his feet. And he realized he could move, even though he was suffering from the excruciating pain of that burning acid in the stomach of that whale. And he heard the pebbles at the bottom of the ocean making tasbih, glorifying Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And he realized that he was alive. And he submits himself to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and repents. And he makes sujood and he calls upon Allah and says, "Oh Allah, I'm calling you from a place that I don't think anyone else has ever called you from before. I doubt that anyone else has ever been in the situation that I'm in." And Allahu A'lam, he's probably right, that no one else would have ever called Allah from the stomach of a whale at the bottom of the ocean in the middle of nowhere, a prophet of Allah. And he calls upon Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala with these beautiful words, "La ilaha illa anta subhanaka inni kuntu min al-zalimin." There is absolutely no God, no deity other than you. And how perfect are you, subhanak, how perfect are you, inni kuntu min al-zalimin. I was from the transgressors. An acknowledgement of Allah's perfection and an acknowledgement of his own imperfection. And he continues to make this dua in the bottom of that ocean. فَاصْبِرْ لِحُكْمِ رَبِّكَ وَلَا تَكُنْ كَصَاحِبِ الْحُوتِ إِذْ نَادَى وَهُوَ مَكْذُومٌ لَوْلَا أَنْ تَدَارَكَهُ نِعْمَةٌ مِنْ رَبِّي. Had not a blessing of Allah fountain, the ni'mah of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala fountain. And subhanAllah, the beginning of the surah was مَا أَنْتَ بِنِعْمَةِ رَبِّكَ بِمَجْنُونَ. By the ni'mah, by the blessing of your Lord, you are not a madman. Had not the ni'mah of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala found you, لَنُبِذَ بِالْعَرَاءِ وَهُوَ مَذْمُومٌ. He would have laid bare, dead, and blameworthy, and sinful. Now, this is something that's crucial. Because with Yunus alayhi salam, he calls upon Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And did he ever ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to get him out of the stomach of the whale? Did he ever ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, "Oh Allah, give me another chance, get me out of this stomach and I'll be better"? No. He called upon Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala with tawbah, thinking that he's probably going to die. And he called upon Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala with tawbatan nasuha. And this is one of the biggest problems that we have sometimes in our tawbah, in our repentance to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. We're only repenting because we face the worldly consequences of our sins. And we want Allah to fix that for us. So I suffered because of something haram I did, and I'm calling upon Allah, astaghfirullah. Why? Because I've been shamed, humiliated. You know, my family hates me perhaps. I've broken off a relationship. I've lost money on this sin. So, oh Allah, astaghfiruka wa atubu ilayk. But in reality, what I really want is to get out of this mess that I'm in right now. But Yunus alayhi salam calls upon Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala for no other reason and for no other purpose except seeking his forgiveness. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said, had the ni'mah of Allah not come to him, he would have been laid bare and he was blameworthy. Instead, that whale spits him out onto an island. And he lays there, completely naked, with no clothes, completely covered in acid under the hot burning sun. And continues to burn in that sun, saying those same words, La ilaha illa anta subhanaka. Inni kuntu min al-zalimin. How perfect are you? How perfect are you? I was from the transgressors. Continuing to make that dua. And when he finally recovers and he goes back to his people, he finds that his people are coming to him, begging him for guidance, begging him to teach them the deen. Go ahead and teach us. We are ready. We have sought forgiveness from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala as well. There are so many lessons that can be derived from this story. And it's very difficult for us to deal with all of them in just a short khutbah. But at the same time, there are many lessons to us as individuals, especially those that are working in the field of La ilaha illallah Muhammadur Rasulullah, that are trying to establish da'wah in this country, that are trying to deliver this message, that are trying to establish institutions for years to come, projects for years to come. On the individual level, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala shows us something very crucial. And that is that if Allah would have left Yunus alayhi salam to himself, think about this. If Allah let Yunus give up, walk away, and let Yunus alayhi salam go on the ship and left him to himself in khudlan, just completely abandoned, Yunus alayhi salam would have gotten himself killed. Why? Because Yunus would have been overthrown, he would have been thrown off of that ship, and he would have drowned eventually, and he would have died.
Think about that for a moment. And so a person should never wish to be left alone by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and a person should never wish that he has his own affairs in his own hand. And that's why we're taught to say every morning and every evening, Ya Hayyu Ya Qayyum, bi rahmatika astaghith, aslih li sha'ni kulla, wa la takilni ila nafsi tarfata'in. You call upon Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, Al-Hayy, Al-Qayyum, the one who never ceases to live and who never ceases to be in control of that which is under his power, never ceases to sustain. Bi rahmatika astaghith, I seek refuge in your mercy. Aslih li sha'ni kulla, fix all of my affairs, correct all of my affairs, and don't leave me to myself. وَلَا تَكِلْنِي إِلَىٰ نَفْسِي, I never want to be left alone by you, O Allah. Don't leave my affairs to me or entrust me with my own affairs, not even for the blink of an eye. I need you, O Allah, for my dunya and for my akhirah. And so Yunus alayhi salam, had he been left alone, he would have died. Instead, although the pain that he went through was excruciating, instead, he survived because Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala sent that whale that swallowed him and eventually spit him out. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says after that though, and this is something that's very crucial as well, فَجِتَبَاهُ رَبُّهُ وَجَعَلَهُ مِنَ الصَّالِحِينَ. Allah chose Yunus alayhi salam as a result of what he went through. And what this shows you is that التَّائِبُ مِنَ الذَّنْبِ, number one, the one who repents from a sin, كَمَنْ لَا ذَنْبَ لَهُ, is like the one who has never sinned before. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala not only purifies you as a result of your sin, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala actually put Yunus alayhi salam in a higher station, with higher regard after that tawbah. And this is something that Allah azza wa jalla teaches us with Adam alayhi salam. Adam alayhi salam made a mistake. But at the same time, as Imam Ibn al-Qayyim rahimahullah, he said that Shaytan thought that he succeeded whenever he caused Adam alayhi salam to make that mistake. But what he didn't realize is that whenever the diver dives, عِندَمَا يَغُوسُ الْغَوَّاسُ, when the diver dives to the bottom of the ocean, يَجْمَعُ اللُّؤْلُؤُ, he gathers the pearls at the bottom of that ocean, ثُمَّ يَرْتَفِعْ مَرَّةً أُخْرَى, and he rises once again. Adam alayhi salam was better in the sight of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala after his tawbah. Yunus alayhi salam was better in the sight of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala after his tawbah, was chosen. And that's why the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, لا يقولن أحدكم, no one of you should say, أنا خير من يونس, that I am better than Yunus. And the ulama, they differed whether that not the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam is better than Yunus, or whether no person should say that as a means of degradation, as it comes in the hadith in Sahih Muslim, Hadith Qudsi, لا ينبغي لعبد لي, that it is not permissible for a servant of mine, it is not befitting for a servant of mine to say أنا خير من يونس, that I am better than يونس. Don't ever think for a moment that you are. Yes, he made that mistake, but look what happens as a result. A legendary dua, a legendary tawbah, a legendary example of why one should never give up on Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala or wish to have his own affairs entrusted to him in this dunya or in the akhirah, his worldly or his affairs of the hereafter. And subhanAllah, how amazing is it that the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, because now we come to the lesson in da'wah, the lesson for those who want to do something meaningful for the sake of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, who want to establish the da'wah in this country, how amazing is it that the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam is reminded of Yunus alayhi salam once again on the worst day of his life? What was the worst day of his life? Ta'if. Aisha radiallahu anha asked the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, what was the worst day of your life? And the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he said that there was no day that was worse than the day of Ta'if. Can you imagine the humiliation? Can you imagine what it's like to walk for miles between two lines while the children spit at you, curse you, stone you, beat you, and you just lost your wife, you just lost your uncle, you have no moral, no emotional support, and you have to go through that? You know, subhanAllah, if you look at the reality TV today, a lot of people watch reality TV, and I remember reading a study on reality TV about how they have a policy in reality TV not to let the contestants sleep for more than 2 hours, so that they can easily be irritated. Because even if a person is completely rational and is a very patient person, if you put them through sleep deprivation, if you spit at them, if you break their morale, if you curse at them, then they'll eventually lose it. No reality TV contestant has ever been through what the Prophet ﷺ went through in reality. No one of us has ever been through that. And at that moment, Allah Azza wa Jalla sends the angels to the Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam, Jibreel Alayhi Salaam, and the angel who controls the mountains, and gives the Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam a chance of vengeance. Even the most patient person in the world would have taken that and said, yes, you know what? I'm done with these people. 10 years, and there's no use in these people. They've rejected me. They've even gotten worse as I called upon them more. But Allah Azza wa Jalla also sends the Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam a young man on that day, as the Prophet ﷺ was beaten and belittled, alayhi salatu wasalam, by the people, and cursed and emotionally, you know, just traumatized. And he stood in that garden covered in blood, alayhi salatu wasalam, and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala sent to him a young man by the name of Addas. And this young slave was sent by his masters, who noticed the Prophet ﷺ in that garden. They felt sorry for him. So they sent him, rather Allah Azza wa Jalla sent him through them, Addas, to come to the Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam with some grapes. And the Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam takes these grapes, and the Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam says, Bismillah, in the name of Allah. And Addas knows, because he's been around pagan Arabs his whole life, that the people of this land don't say Bismillah. Said, where did you learn this from? The people in this land don't say those words. And the Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam said, where are you from? And Addas said, I'm from Nineveh in Iraq. And the Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam said, Min ardi al-abd al-salih wa al-nabi al-salih, from the land of the righteous servant and the righteous prophet, Yunus ibn Matta. And the man, Addas, looks at the Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam and says, وَمَا يُدْرِيكَ أَنَّهُ نَبِي. How would you know that he's a prophet? How do you know anything about Yunus? And the Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam said, Huwa Nabi, he is a prophet, and I am a prophet, and the prophets are brothers. And Addas starts to embrace the Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam and accepts his message on a day when everyone else rejected. What does that show you? How amazing is the qadr of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, the decree of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, that on that day Allah Azza wa Jalla sends one of the offspring of the believers in Yunus alayhi salam to remind the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, you never give up because it was never in your hands anyway. This da'wah was never in your hands. This dunya is not in your hands. Nothing is in your hands, nor should you wish for it to be in your hands. We ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to correct our affairs, to give us success in our worldly affairs and in our affairs of the hereafter, and to protect us from ourselves, and to make us amongst those who remain firm in believing in Him and believing in His power. And we ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to forgive us whenever we forget. Allahumma ameen. Aqulu qawli hadha wa astaghfirullah li wa lakum wa lisa'il muslimin. Fastaghfiru innahu huwal ghafur rahim.
بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم ألف لام ميم
الحمد لله رب العالمين ولا عدوان إلا على الظالمين والعاقبة للمتقين اللهم صل وسلم وبارك على عبدك ورسولك محمد صلى الله عليه وسلم وعلى آله وصحبه وسلم تسليما كثيرا. Dear brothers and sisters, there's a hadith which is narrated in Abu Dawood, and it's an authentic, it's a Hassan hadith, in which an incident takes place with Umar ibn al-Khattab radiallahu ta'ala anhu during his khilafah, where Sa'd ibn Abi Waqqas radiallahu ta'ala anhu comes to Umar ibn al-Khattab radiallahu anhu and says, Ya Amir al-Mu'mineen, I want to complain to you about Uthman ibn Affan radiallahu anhu. Can you imagine Uthman having a complaint against him? And Umar radiallahu anhu said, what is it, what possibly could Uthman have done that the uncle of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam is coming and complaining about him? And so Sa'd radiallahu ta'ala anhu said, has anything changed in Islam? Umar radiallahu anhu said, no. He said, because I walked by Uthman ibn Affan and I said to him, Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh, and he didn't respond to me. So I wondered why he's not responding to my salam. So Umar radiallahu anhu said, this is strange. So he took Sa'd and they went to Uthman to see what was going on. And so Umar radiallahu anhu goes to Uthman and he tells Uthman, why didn't you respond to the salam of Sa'd? He said, Sa'd never said salam to me. He said, what are you talking about? Sa'd never said salam to me. And Sa'd radiallahu anhu insisted, I said salam to you. And Uthman said, you never said salam to me. And so they kept on arguing about this until Sa'd reminded Uthman, and Uthman radiallahu ta'ala anhu, he remembered a moment when he was deeply engrossed in thought And Sa'd radiallahu anhu passed by him and said salam, and he forgot to say wa alaykum as-salam. So Uthman radiallahu anhu started to apologize, and he told him that I was trying to remember a du'a that the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam taught us, a du'a that would relieve any person in distress. And Sa'd radiallahu ta'ala anhu said, I will tell you the du'a, I will inform you of the du'a you were trying to think of. He said, I remember when we were sitting with the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, and the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, shall I not inform you all of a du'a that if the one who is in hardship or anxiety says it, then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will surely relieve him of his distress? As the Prophet said that, an Arabi man, a Bedouin man, interrupted him and started asking him questions, and the Prophet never told him the du'a. As we see happen in so many different narrations, people become impatient, they interrupt the Prophet, and so the entire community is deprived. Sa'd was there. And Sa'd said, I followed the Prophet after that, and I followed him home. And he said, just as the Prophet ﷺ was about to enter into his house, I started to stop my feet and make some noise so that the Prophet ﷺ would notice me. And he said, so Rasulullah ﷺ turned around and he said, what is it, O Sa'd? Sa'd radiallahu ta'ala anhu said, ya Rasulullah, you didn't finish telling us that du'a, that if the person in anxiety and in distress says it, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will surely relieve him of his hardship. And Rasulullah ﷺ said, that du'a is the du'a of my brother Yunus. لا إله إلا أنت سبحانك إني كنت من الظالمين. Anytime you acknowledge Allah's perfection and acknowledge your own imperfection, you can expect amazing things to happen in your life, and you can expect Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to make things easy for you, whether you're pursuing the dunya or whether you are pursuing the da'wah or whether you are pursuing your own status in al-jannah. Dear brothers and sisters, we have unique opportunities, walhamdulillah, living in this country to establish these masajid, to establish these Islamic centers. And this special Islamic center, this special masjid that you're a part of right now, alhamdulillah, which is growing. And I'm proud to be a part of it, and I'm proud that we get to enjoy the benefits of those people that established a masjid in Valley Ranch, which people all over the country look towards. We have a unique opportunity, inshallah ta'ala. Please do come and support it bi'idhnillahi ta'ala next Friday at our annual fundraiser, inshallah ta'ala. And there will be special news and special events, and Sheikh Yasser and myself will also be discussing a 21st century masjid, inshallah ta'ala, what a masjid is supposed to do. And we ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to put barakah in our da'wah, to put barakah in our dunya, to put barakah in our efforts of deen. رَبَّنَا آتِنَا فِي الدُّنْيَا حَسَنَةً وَفِي الْآخِرَةِ حَسَنَةً وَقِنَا عَذَابَ النَّارِ لَا إِلَهَ إِلَّا أَنْتَ سُبْحَانَكَ إِنَّا كُنَّا مِنَ الظَّالِمِينَ رَبَّنَا ظَلَمْنَا أَنْفُسَنَا وَإِنْ لَمْ تَغْفِرْ لَنَا وَتَرْحَمْنَا لَنَكُونَنَّ مِنَ الْخَاسِرِينَ اللهم اغفر لنا وارحمنا واعف عنا ولا تعذبنا اللهم اغفر للمؤمنين والمؤمنات اللهم اغفر للمؤمنين والمؤمنات والمسلمين والمسلمات الأحياء منهم والأموات إنك سميع قريب مجيب الدعوات اللهم اغفر لوالدينا رب ارحمهما كما ربونا صغارا ربنا هب لنا من أزواجنا وذرياتنا قرة أعين وجعلنا للمتقين إماما اللهم عز الإسلام والمسلمين وأذل الشرك والكاذبين ودمر أعداء الدين اللهم أهلك الظالمين بالظالمين وأخرجنا وإخواننا من بينهم سالمين عباد الله إن الله يأمر بالعدل والإحسان وإيتاء ذي القربى وينهى عن الفحشاء والمنكر والبغي يعظكم لعلكم تذكرون فاذكروا الله يذكركم واشكروه على نعمائه يزدكم ولذكر الله أكبر والله يعلم ما تصنعون وأقيموا الصلاة
ذلك الكتاب لا ريب فيه هدى للمتقين الذين يؤمنون بالغيب ويقيمون الصلاة ومما رزقناهم